Now we're going to turn our focus to the future of the workplace and what that might look like here in Asia. Please help me welcome to the stage Eunice Yoon. As you know, she is senior correspondent and China bureau chief for CNBC based in Beijing. She'll be joined by her panelists, Adaire Fox Martin, president of Asia Pacific Japan at SAP, and Miki Tsusaka, senior partner and managing director at the Boston Consulting Group. Welcome, panelists.
Hey everyone, so whenever I think of talent, labor, the workplace, in Asia, I think of a north-south divide. That Asia has a north-south divide where China, Japan, South Korea, Taiwan here in Hong Kong all have issues of aging population, low birth rate. The two biggest economies, Japan and China, have shrinking workforces. And then whereas in the South, and I'm talking India, South Asia, Southeast Asia, Philippines, with the exception of, say, Singapore, the issues are different, where you have large populations, young populations, and a rapidly growing workforce. So the challenges are obviously different for companies. And so let's just get some ideas as to how you tackle some of these challenges. So Adaire, first to you, for Southeast Asia and South Asia, countries with large populations there, what do you think needs to be done to do a better job of preparing the workers there for the 21st century?
Well, you're definitely right. I think Asia is definitely a beautiful story of two extremes, right? In the same region, we have industrialized and emerging markets, and we have countries that are aging rapidly and countries that have wonderful, young, enthusiastic, energetic, and initiative in population. And when I look at Southeast Asia for SAP and some of the challenges that we'd see, in terms of bringing talent in, we certainly are quite a young company. Our average age in Asia is 34, and 59% of our workforce fall into the early talent category across the region. But we have to train on the way in. I think when I look at the education systems, when I look at the skills that come into us, particularly maybe it's our sector, high tech, that there is so much lacking in the skills training, the real world skill training that is given to individuals as they come into the workforce.
Is there any one country that you think is doing a pretty good job of managing this large population, making sure people are trained? I stumped you.
Okay. No, you didn't stump me. I'm trying to think of a good way to say I'm not really seeing that at the level that I would love to see it in Southeast Asia.
So, Miki, then, looking at maybe the other extreme, in Japan, I would say Japan is a leading test case for the problems of an aging population and low birth rate and shrinking workforce. So do you think that Japan is doing a good job of managing those issues? And if not, what could they be doing to make sure that things are better?
Well, it's certainly doing a better job now than it did before. But I think combining that with the issue of working women, for example, we rank 111 out of 144 countries, according to the World Economic Forum. And we're running really, thank you. Despite all that we're trying to do, whether it's the Abe administration or individual corporates, I think what's happening is we're all running hard, but the world is running faster ahead of us. So we remain behind, and I do think we are literally in a war for talent and a crisis situation. But the world's in crisis too. We've done some work across, say, 25 economies around the world. The world will face a talent shortage in about 2030. Even China, that is growing like hotcakes today, will likely face a talent shortage in 2030. But to your point, the southern cone of Asia, like in India, will be just fine. So in that context, I do think that we've got to figure this out. We used to be the poster child of growth when I came out of college. Japan is number one, and I was based in the U.S. for 20 years. I come back, and oh my God, it's not a good situation. So I do think that there are, however, solutions. I won't talk to the policy stuff, but certainly things like improving productivity, improving immigration, improving support we have for working families, all of those are the same policies, procedures, initiatives that most other countries already have, and we're just catching up. And then I do think there's a lot of things that individual corporates can do. Mm. And it doesn't take a village of, you know, hundreds of people. I do think a few people at the top can make a difference. And I think we're seeing some interesting examples.
Well, what do workers in Asia want? Is it different from workers in Europe or in the United States?
So, again, we've done some research. I think it was over 20,000-30,000 people around the world across 2,000 companies, and we asked that question. And it's interesting, there are pockets of Asians that really do want to go global. I know we were talking earlier about globalization, and oh my God, is it the end of globalization? Countries like the Philippines, countries like Taiwan rank really high in terms of their desire for mobility. It may not be surprised that countries like the U.S., you know, only 30% of the workforce wants to go. You talk to the French and Germans, they're even lower. So I do think there's hope in terms of mobility if the laws above and the countries that are having these discussions now allow that. That is one way to, you know, unlock the growth potential in terms of talent and moving them across borders.
Mm-hmm. I have to admit, when we look at what employees want in Asia, it's interesting to me that it isn't always about the benefits, right? It's about the whole experience of working and the whole experience of being engaged and how the company that you work for contributes back to the society that we operate and work and serve. And that's a very significant part, I think, of certainly our policy, and I know other organizations in Asia, in order to ensure that in what is a very talent-strapped market, again, I'm speaking particularly to high tech, that we are able to not just attract, but also retain the top talent in order to better serve our customers and their outcomes.
So what does that mean in practical terms if you're a multinational company and you're in Asia and you're trying to retain the best talent, and what do you need to do?
Well, I think there are a whole series of things that we need to look at and accept. First of all, I think our workforce today is very multi-generational. At the moment in SAP, we have 5 generations under one roof. So it doesn't mean that you have to have a focus on a hiring process that would focus specifically on millennials or a career progression focus that focuses specifically again on millennials. You have to have a flavor of how you're managing your staff that allows you to deal with this multi-generational capability that exists in your organization. And I actually love that because millennials come with enthusiasm, energy, and passion, and the older gray hairs sometimes give, you know, that depth of experience that enables all of that passion to be captured. So that's the first thing. Yeah. I think the second element that we need to look at is how we actually hire, because all of us hire in our own image. And particularly when we're looking at increasing diversity in our workforce, the opportunity to be diverse gives you a greater opportunity further in your life cycle to innovate, because it's key to have that diverse frame of reference in order to appropriately innovate. And when I look at hiring, I think it's very important that we hire beyond bias. And now there are tools and techniques available in the market that allow you to do that, allow you to look and use things like artificial intelligence and some of those elements to actually do a first match that removes some of the bias from your hiring, that creates a much more diverse environment for your company.
So it sounds like you're saying expand the talent pool.
Exactly.
Find a way.
Mm-hmm. So keep the pool much broader, make the barrel that you're fishing in much larger. For example, in our organization, we haven't just looked at the traditional sources. You know, there's traditional sources for us in terms of whether that's competitors or companies that are complementary. But we've also expanded that in a couple of areas. One is in the area of people who have special abilities, not disabilities, but special abilities, and making it much easier for people, for example, in the context of SAP, who are on the autistic spectrum to come back into work. We've had tremendous success with that program, and the innovation that individuals on that spectrum bring to our company is absolutely incredible. The other major program that I also think is important is around the older worker, right? So, in Hong Kong, Korea, and Singapore, Adaco has said that older workers are now, increasing the workforce by a factor of 28 to 33% compared to 5 years ago. We launched a program called Back to Work, which is around women who have taken a career break and want to come back into the workplace. Now, that's been a tremendous success for us. We found the most amazing women who all were chief logistics officers, chief financial officers, chief healthcare officers at home, and were able to take that skill that we've placed a value on and bring it back into the workforce.
I wanted to ask a little bit more about that. Just how does gender play a role in your hiring, in your talent pool, what you think about in the workplace?
Right. I think, again, we need to continue to use both genders, yes, or whatever variations thereof in the world to grow the economy of the world, because we just don't have enough talent. And in fact, to your question about differences, men and women do look for different things based on our research. Again, this one was, I think, a panel of 300,000 employers around the world. And it's, you mentioned, Adele, the millennials and what, yes, they want is different. Yeah. Indeed, we're seeing that in spades, both men and women. What was surprising to me was that the number one thing that came up for women and men was this notion around being appreciated. Mm. And that's such a soft thing.
Yeah.
Compensation was on the bottom of the top 10 list, believe it or not. I was thinking number 7 or something, which really surprised us. But it was appreciation for the work you do, the quality of your colleagues that you're working with, and of course, work-life blend, life-work blend, all those kind of balanced dimensions, not only for the youth that are being recruited, but for the older generation. And then below, there was corporate values, strategy, vision. It's all there. Mm-hmm. But women, I think, tend to, again, based on this research globally and true in Asia as well,
yes,
pivot stronger to that. In addition to recruiting, though, I think the other challenge is to keep them. There,
yes,
were panelists,
right,
earlier talking about the BAT and how quickly talent can disappear to the next opportunity if you're in a China. And so I think keeping them is as important. And one of the, again, gender-specific lenses we looked at is indeed how we provide feedback and keeping, retaining your employees. We're very lucky in our firm. We have, I think, about 500,000 people that come to our recruiting website globally. We only hire 1% of them, so we know they're out there.
Wow.
And yet we lose, like the industry average, probably 15% a year. So there's a constant churn. But women react to strength-based feedback. You're great, however, but you're great. As opposed to boom, boom, boom. And so, this is, I know this is US-based data, but I found this also very curious. You know, the average American woman apparently talks 20,000 words a day. 20,000 words a day. I know we only have 2 gentlemen in the room. Any guesses as to the average word count of men? It's 1/3.
Wow.
And yet, when they get into the boardroom and positions of leadership and they find themselves in minorities, men keep talking. And we don't.
Yes.
So again, I think I long did not want to believe that men and women were different.
Yeah.
I've been in this business now 30 years. I now get that there's some facts about where we are slightly different. And I think accommodating those attributes in the way you develop talent, I think, is also a very
key,
important piece.
Actually, it's interesting on that topic. One of our formal training programs that we insist every manager, it's a mandatory program for every manager, is Leading Men and Women. So it's actually a program that focuses on how you manage diverse gender-based teams, because we found, that there were specific examples where, managers had not had an experience of managing a team like that. And just as an aside, I did learn a lot. I learned a lot. That surprised me and explained some aspects of my marriage that I hadn't understood. For example, when my husband is sitting on the couch watching the sofa and I ask him, what is he thinking about? Now, in a woman, we'd be doing our list, right, in our head, all of the other things we have to do. When I ask him what he's thinking about and he says nothing, he really means it. And that was something after 28 years of marriage that I learned on that course.
Well, I'm just going to open up the floor now to see if anybody has
opening
any
on that one.
Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah, please.
Hello, Sue Martin from Johnson & Johnson.
Sure.
There's been a lot of discussion about diversity, both in this session and a lot of the questions have related to talent during the day. I'm just very keen to get your opinion on quotas. Is this something that we should be encouraging in our organisation, or do you think it's an antiquated method that potentially leads to tokenism? Very interested on your views.
So I don't like quotas, but I like what they do.
Yeah,
is something
exactly.
I think the head of one of the OECD said a few years ago. I think if you look at what's happening, for example, in the Nordic countries, there's a
fine representation. In fact, perhaps even some would say an overrepresentation of women in boards, 30-40%. The dark side to that is that the same women are rotating around the same board. So I think you have to be careful not to overdo it. In Japan, Prime Minister Abe said 20-20-30. When he first said that, I thought, oh my God, that's impossible, because we were at 3% management. And mathematically, as a consultant, you knew the numbers. There was no way he was going to get there. He just revised it to 20-20-10. So what do? I think corporations should have aspirations. Some they may call it targets. Some companies have incentive systems around it. Some don't. I think you have to do what's right for that corporate environment. I do believe having some numbers in terms of what you're targeting for is a good thing, but that ultimately it is around, you know, quality and not quantity only.
Yeah. I agree. I don't like the whole concept, as you mentioned, Sue, of the checkbox and being anybody's checkbox. But I do think that quotas allow us to manage pretty much like any other KPI in the business. It's something that we can hold our managers accountable to. Where we tend to manage it is at the front end of the process, so on the recruitment process. And when you get to a shortlist for a senior leadership position, you know, is the diversity of the region reflected in that shortlist, or do you have a shortlist that looks very similar? And when you measure your executive recruiters and your recruiting organization on the front end of the funnel, then you can actually really begin to change the dynamics of the business all the way through. And I found that to be a very effective mechanism for introducing diversity, particularly in cultures in Asia, like Japan and like Korea, particularly in high-tech sales where there aren't a lot of women.
Hey, I had the opportunity to ask Mr. Carlos Ghosn once, you know, if there's a woman and a man, which one would you hire? And there was a Japanese CEO that preceded answering that question. He said, well, in this world in Japan, Ms. Tsusaka, we really should probably figure out whether we can promote the woman first if she has the skills, blah, blah, blah. And then Mr. Ghosn was brilliant. He said, okay, they're exactly the same, right? He said, yes, assume they're exactly the same. Which one would you hire and promote? He said, well, we are a growing company, so I would hire and promote them both. And I think
great answer.
Back to, you know, all sorts of diversity. We happen to be at the Fortune's women's thing, so we're talking about women. I do think that, again, there's statistical research that shows diversity is good for business of all kinds. So I think, you know, corporations that can embrace that and act on it will have an advantage versus those that don't.
Any questions?
Thank you. Well, we talk about talent perspective, and I think you manage about engaging talent as a total experience. So, you know, when I look at managing talent from an MNC perspective, I realize that most of the time, those on the top, we call high potential, and also those at the bottom, like we spend most of the time managing the top and also the bottom. So my question and also my curiosity is for talking about, I want to know your view about, you know, how we actually motivate and engage those in the middle. Because, you know, if you look around, most of the organization or most of the people that actually, they end up in this category, right? Because they are actually, they're the people become the majority. So I really appreciate the view.
I'll take that first.
Thank you.
Actually, this is the first year that we're doing away with those rankings. Mm. So we're completely doing away with performance rankings in our company, which is interesting considering that, you know, we do have a pay for performance basis in our culture. And what we're swapping it to is a discussion around the development of that individual and the needs and the requirements of the business, which I think previous panelists have spoken to how rapidly transforming our industry is. And how the digital imperative is driving a change in most organizations, ourselves included. So we really focus very much on each individual. At the moment, I can say that 82% of our staff in Asia have a personal development plan that is monitored by their manager, and that their manager, again, on a measure, is held accountable to ensuring that that is there. And that, for me, is a much, much more positive outcome than having a you're a high potential, you're a low potential, you're a risk, you're a middle of the road type conversation with an individual. It's about personalizing that process on a per individual basis. And it's possible for us to do it in a company of our scale. I think it's possible for most companies to do that too.
That's fascinating and great that you're already there. I remember, again, joining our firm many, many moons ago, and instead of strengths and weaknesses on that PowerPoint slide, it said strengths and areas for development.
Yes, challenges and opportunities, yes. Okay.
And of course, you know, we all want to focus on that side of the chart, but to your point about motivating the middle, I think it's an excellent point. You know, most corporate programs, you know, reward the best by sending them around the world, big bonuses, and then you spend a lot of time trying to help, you know, people that you may be moving on. We call them graduates in our firm to great places. It just may not be here and now. So I think it's actually, seriously, joking aside, I do think it starts with the language. High, low, medium, you know, not good. I mean, who wants to be, you're terrific, you had an average year. It just doesn't sound good to anyone. So I think it is about what is your personal potential, as big as, you know, corporations like SAP are, we're tiny relative to that. I think having a sense of individual direction, what the potential is for that person, it's a lot more work for the HR people, but it's also a lot of work that the individual, I think, has to do. They have to chart their own course and figure out where they want to go next and do all they can to do that. But I think it's an excellent question. I don't think I've answered it very well, but I completely agree with the problem.
Well, I'm going to try to sneak in one more question. I think over there.
Talking about, was specifically interested in your view on your engagement with the younger generation, how you make sure that they continuously engage in a corporate. You mentioned that actually in SAP you have five generations working for the same firm. Is there any special efforts you're doing to make sure that the younger generations, you know, millennial and even younger, are engaged?
Yeah, as I mentioned, 59% of our workforce fall into that category. So we do, and we completely change from the hiring process, the onboarding process, and then the process all the way through the development of people's careers. You know, millennials want to make moves, and they want to make moves quite quickly. We have to be able to show and demonstrate path all the way through. We have found that rooftop cocktail bars in various cities are very good recruiting grounds for millennials. And we actually have our talent win plan focused on a whole series of activities that are very social and very engaging. And also, as I said, this higher purpose. We run a program called 1 Billion Lives in Asia Pacific Japan, which is about SAP impacting 1 billion lives in this region. And we do it through a series of startup accelerators in the company, and the millennials are so key to that, and also so inspired by it. And it is those kind of things outside of the task of your daily work that I think allows us to attract and retain our millennial talent.
All right, thank you very much. Moving very quickly right along to the next panelist.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.